Hi, everybody. My name is Lisa Kaltenegger. I'm the director of the Carl Sagan Institute here at Cornell. And we just finished watching The Sacrifice of Cassini, an episode of the New Cosmos Possible Worlds NatGeo television show. And we wanted to bring you some of the in-depth science. So here goes, The Science of Cosmos.
I'm Jonathan Lunin. I'm a professor of astronomy and fellow of the Carl Sagan Institute at Cornell University.
My name is Alexander Hayes. I'm a professor of astronomy at Cornell as well, and also a fellow of the Carl Sagan Institute.
My name is Mariam El-Mutamid, and I am an expert in orbital dynamics and celestial mechanics, especially for the three-body problems. I work currently at Cornell as a research associate, and I am a member of the Carl Sagan Institute.
So, we just watched The Sacrifice of Cassini. Jonathan, you actually had a big role in that mission. Can you tell us about it?
I was an interdisciplinary scientist on Cassini and Huygens, the probe that landed on Titan. And my area of responsibility officially was Titan, its surface and atmosphere, but it broadened out as the mission went on to Enceladus and other icy moons. And I started on Cassini before it was Cassini, when it was still being studied as a potential mission way back in the 1980s.
When Cassini brought all this information back, what for you were the scientific highlights that you just thought were fascinating that the mission brought you?
For me, the two highlights of Cassini were the discovery of the lakes and seas of methane on Titan, and the discovery that Enceladus might be a place where life exists under the surface and where we could actually go and look for that life in relatively simple ways. Enceladus, it turns out, we didn't know this before Cassini, has a giant plume of vapor and ice that's pouring out of the South Polar region. Cassini was able to show us that it's coming from an ocean underneath the ice crust. And further, Cassini was able to actually fly through this plume of material and sample it, to actually taste it with its instruments. And it was able to tell us that the ice is actually salty, that there's salt in the ice, and there are molecules containing carbon in the ice, organic compounds. And further, that there are minerals, silicon dioxide, which suggests that there is chemistry going on in this ocean, at its base, with a rocky core. And so Cassini mapped out for us a world where in the interior, there is what on the Earth we call a hydrothermal system, where chemistry is going on, and perhaps where life itself exists.
One of the things that you just mentioned was also the other moon. So Enceladus being this icy moon that potentially could host life, as the thermophiles we know here on the bottom of the ocean on the Earth. But the other moon, Titan, enshrouded in the clouds with having lake systems. Alex, you're an expert on Titan. Can you give us a feeling what it might be like on Titan and what for you were the highlights that the Cassini mission brought?
Sure, I certainly can. In fact, behind me, this is an artist's rendition of what it might look like to sit on the surface of Titan, which is Saturn's largest satellite and the only one that we know of with a substantial atmosphere. In fact, the air on Titan's surface is four times denser than the air in the room you're sitting. And because the temperatures are much lower, it actually allows substances such as methane and ethane to flow on the surface as a liquid and collect into lakes and seas like you see in the picture behind me. But if we take this picture behind me and you just think of what a typical lakefront vacation home might see here on Earth, the view you might get from the back deck of your vacation home, you can make a few subtle changes and turn it into this picture that we're seeing in the video. If we just remove the vegetation and let the sky go to a little bit more orange instead of the blue that we're used to, we really could be sitting on the edge of a Titan lake. And the story of Cassini and its exploration of Titan is, in my opinion, the story of unexpected discovery. And it's shown us things that are both strange and familiar. And Titan is both strange and familiar. At its equator, you can find sand dunes similar in size to the largest dunes that we see in the Saharan Sea in Africa. You have alluvial fans, which are deposits that are left at the end of rivers that resemble those that you can find in the Atacama Desert of Chile. There are mountain chains similar to the Himalayas, and perhaps most astonishingly, these lakes and seas that scatter the polar landscape of Titan. However, the dunes that you see near its equator are not made of silicate sand like you'd find at the beach. Instead, they're made of what is compositionally most closest resembling plastic particles or hydrocarbon grains. And rather than those mountains being made of rock, they're actually being made of pieces of dirty water ice, frozen ice that's combined with these organic materials, these plastic-like components. And these similarities make Titan a natural laboratory for studying the same things that change Earth's surface, but doing so in vastly different environmental conditions. And you also asked what my favorite discoveries were on Titan. Well, I'm fascinated by Titan's lakes and seas, and also by the way the Cassini mission explored them. So Cassini was a multi-generational mission. I got involved right when I started graduate school, just when we were entering the Saturn system for the first time. And it was amazing to watch the team work together. Cassini was a very international team, and they adapted very well to new discoveries of things that we never thought we'd see when the mission was conceived. And one of those was these lakes and seas on Titan and the spacecraft's ability to use its radar instrument to actually probe their depth like you would use a depth sounder or a fish finder here on Earth. And when we made that discovery that you could actually see through the base of these seas, this was initially discovered by an Italian scientist who at the time was a postdoctoral scholar named Marco Mastro Giuseppe. We went and changed the way the end of the mission actually was implemented in order to take advantage of that new discovery. And it was really great to see that entire mission work together and adapt what it's doing based on new discoveries made by young scientists who in some cases weren't even born, and in other cases were just in primary school when the mission was launched in the mid-1990s.
So when we go back and think about Saturn, one of the most iconic things, of course, around Saturn are those rings. And right now, we are actually trying to find rings also around other worlds, exoplanets, and we found the first cases that could potentially have massive ring systems. But of course, the one case in our own solar system that we think about is Saturn. While all the giant planets actually have rings, Saturn's rings stand out. And so, Mariam, as an expert in the ring structures, especially also around Saturn, can you tell us what the most interesting things are around those ring structures on Saturn and what Cassini found out?
So, the rings of Saturn are the most fascinating rings. They are very spectacular and beautiful. But they are not only spectacular and beautiful. They contain a lot of information that we need to understand for both the connection between the ring of Saturn and the formation of the moon of Saturn, and the connection between the ring of Saturn and the interior of the planet itself.
And so what you're telling us is actually that you can use these beautiful rings around Saturn to probe its interior?
Absolutely, this is the goal. We cannot have access to the interior, but we can use the ring as a seismograph to probe the interior of the planet, indeed.
At the end of Cassini's lifetime, didn't Cassini actually go and dip through the rings? Was there something unexpected that was found in those last dramatic orbits?
Yes, you are completely right. So, as you know, in September 2017, the Cassini spacecraft was crashed into Saturn's atmosphere on purpose, providing unique in-situ and remote sensing observation on its final orbit. So, after losing a radio contact with Earth, Cassini became part of the planet itself. So on this final orbit, Saturn's gravity and magnetic field were measured, and the accuracy was similar that Juno provided for Jupiter, for example. So many results were published by scientists from around the world. Some of the most exciting results are unexpected rain of carbon-rich material that was discovered falling from the D-ring, which is the closest ring to the planet. So falling from the D-ring into the planet's equatorial atmosphere. But even before this, Cassini spent 13 solid years in orbit around Saturn, collecting data with its 13 science instruments and teaching us a great deal about the planet, the ring, the satellite, and the magnetosphere, and the subtle connection between them. Also, most of the most fascinating observations done by Cassini include some new moon and moonlets in the ring. These moon, small moons are big enough to open a gap. Some of these moons are not that big to open a gap, but trying to. So this is a very interesting dynamical behavior. And as I said, some subtle waves or structures in the ring that reveal not only the effect of distant sunlight, but also perturbations due to internal oscillation and localized mass anomaly deep within the planet. So many of these results and phenomena are dynamical and gravitational in origin, involving processes that, such as orbital resonances and tides and so on. But several big questions remain hotly debated, notably the most famous one, which is the origin and the age of the ring and icy satellites. So we should come back there to investigate and learn more.
Jonathan, you were there when Cassini basically made its final plunge into Saturn's atmosphere. You were there at JPL with the team of scientists.
Being there in the last week was very tense, and every meeting that we had, which in fact this was a project science group meeting, so we had our usual meetings, but every one was the last one. And finally, when the night came that Cassini plunged into Saturn and the spacecraft broke apart and vaporized, at that point I actually felt a great sense of relief, because we knew it had to end at some time, this 20-year odyssey in space, this 13-year odyssey around Saturn. It couldn't go forever. All good things come to an end. And so when it finally did, it was time to celebrate all the wonderful things that Cassini actually did. I think that what makes the Cassini mission remarkable is not only the discoveries that it made, but the fact that the spacecraft could actually follow up on those discoveries and make genuinely new and qualitatively different discoveries about those very things that it had discovered previously. So for example, in the case of Enceladus, it discovered the plume and then could fly through the plume and tell us what it was actually made of, something that no one had thought about doing when the mission was actually being constructed. And so Cassini will go down in history as one of the most remarkable planetary missions ever designed by human beings.
Cassini has actually ended its journey around Saturn, but the data and what we can glean from it is not over yet, is it, Alex?
No. So while the spacecraft may have disintegrated into Saturn's atmosphere, the data live on. And there are generations of PhDs and future scientific discoveries that we can expect to come from Cassini. In fact, you can process the data in new and exciting ways that can actually discover new things and give us images at higher resolutions, things that allow us to see smaller features we haven't seen before. And so Cassini gave us a gift of its data, and that gift will keep on going. And the Cassini mission, the spacecraft may have ended, but the Cassini mission has not. And we still have generations of students and scientists that'll be looking at that data and coming up with new and exciting discoveries.
We've watched the episode, The Sacrifice of Cassini, in the New Cosmos show, and we talked and gave you some insights about some of the science behind it. There's a lot more to cover, of course. If you're curious about the science behind Cosmos, if you're curious about trying to find life in the universe, follow us at the Carl Sagan Institute or come back here for another discussion with different Carl Sagan fellows about the science behind Cosmos.